And to keep claiming that these are general things that should be applicable in any place or time is a matter that needs a much more careful analysis. But let me take some of the issues of objection they raise. First, they say that the Quran uses a derogatory term to refer to those who do not accept Islam. You call them kafirs or kuffar, and say that those kafirs are going to land in the hellfire. They will be entered. And they say that this is an obvious derogatory remark about people who did not wish to accept Islam. It's not very friendly. Not only this, it evokes hatred and violence, because the Muslim knows that, or at least is told, that those kafirs are going to the hellfire. First thing, the fact that there should be no blurring of the line between Iman and Kufr is indisputable. But is there anywhere in the Quran an authority giving to the Muslim to punish the person who is a kafir? He's peaceful, but he's a kafir. He chose not to accept Islam. Is there any provision that one should punish him in this world here? None whatsoever. Therefore, we must say that a Muslim should be spiritually humble as well. And you know, there's a hadith Qudsi, when somebody made a statement, Allah will never forgive that person. And Allah says in the hadith Qudsi, who is that person who's, you know, putting himself ahead of me? I have forgiven that person and I've punished you. A Muslim should be humble. And who said even that a believer who claimed to be a believer or Muslim is guaranteed, can say at any point in his life before death, that I am going to the paradise, not like you kafir? You know, Umar radiallahu anhu, in spite of his piety, he says, if I have one foot inside paradise and one foot outside, I would have not been safe from the plan of Allah. What he means here, not that Allah will, you know, arbitrarily, hasha lillah, punish him, but that reflects piety, that if a person towards the end of his life, a person who has been a very good believer, worshipper of Allah, who knows, toward the end of his life he might fall into kufr and rejection of Allah, and he would be entered into paradise, yet he's counted as a Muslim. Likewise, who are we to say that any particular person is going to the hellfire? Who knows, he or she might be guided sometimes during their lifetime and repent to Allah, and Allah would receive them with open arms and forgive them. Who knows? Even a person who dies without accepting Islam, are we in a position to say that they will never be saved? The answer is in the Quran itself. Surah Al-Isra, Surah 17, in Ayah 15, what does it say? Allah says, وَمَا كُنَّا مُعَذِّبِينَ حَتَّى نَبْعَثَ رَسُولًا. We will not punish until we have sent a messenger. So a person could die as a kafir, yes. It's not necessarily an attacking term. Kafir in a sense that he did not believe in Islam. But yet there is a chance for him, if Allah knows that they did not receive the message of Islam. How about if they receive the message of Islam in a distorted way, from a Western source that's not correct, for example, and they were sincere? Who are we to say that? Message of Islam means the correct message of Islam. So are we to judge? So we have to make it clear that the ultimate destiny of a person in paradise or hellfire, it's in the hand of Allah. It is a totally disconnected issue from how you treat people. But then, how do you translate kafir and kuffar, and what is the meaning? There are lots of misunderstanding on that issue. I must say in the first place that the term infidel is a totally inappropriate and insulting derogatory term to use to refer to kafir. Why? Look at the dictionary. The problem that some Muslims don't realize that and think kafir means infidel. In the new Webster dictionary, for example, you know what the word infidel means? A person who has no religious faith, or a person who does not believe in God. And you know, it's not only the lexical meaning, the connotated meaning of infidelity is always negative. When some spouse cheats on his wife or husband, what is that called? Marital infidelity. So the meaning is always negative, infidelity. Why is that term wrong? And we're not saying that to please anyone. but the truth, the objective truth. Why is it a wrong term? It is a wrong term on the authority of the Quran. Remember the ayah that was cited, ayah 46 in Surah Al-Ankabut, Surah 29. What does it say? It says that the Lord of the Jews and Christians is the same Lord of Muslims. إِلَهُنَا وَإِلَهُكُمْ وَاحِدٌ. That doesn't need the New Webster's Dictionary, for example, that people who are faithless. They have a religious faith. They might be wrong theologically from our perspective, but they have a religious faith. They're not atheists. They believe in God. But interestingly enough, and if we have any psychologists here, I'll ask you to think what's the proper term to use here. Oftentimes, Islam is being accused and attacked that it uses the term infidel, even though, like we said, it's not a Quranic term. Again, it's non-Muslims, derogatory term. Yet, do you know who coined the term infidel and was used against whom? It was in medieval Christian Europe that the term infidel was used to describe Muslims who worship their prophet and worship stones and all the other distortions to arouse the hatred in the crusade, during the crusade. So the term was coined in the Christian world, used against Muslims, and then used also to justify the so-called religious wars, even between warring sects within Christianity. Not the Christianity that taught by Jesus, by the way. I'm talking about the actual practice. That's rather interesting. And that's what my question to a psychologist. When something originates from you, and then you try to blame it on someone else, what is that called? What's the term for it? Projection. Projection. One of the worst cases of projection. Therefore, like we did in the term Islam and its root, jihad and its root, I think we ought also to understand the origin of kufr and kafir and its variety of meaning, to be careful as to what exactly do we mean when say that person is a kafir, even if we don't use the term infidel. The word kufr, or the origin, the root kfr or kafra, literally actually means to conceal or cover up. A farmer putting a seed in the ground is committing an act of kufr because he covers it with the soil. No suggestion that you should tell him you're a kafir, because he wouldn't understand the literal meaning. It's a benign kufr. He's covering up the seed in the ground. Secondly, is it possible that a person can remain a Muslim but committing some lesser kufr? Yes, indeed. In Surah Ali Imran, Surah 3, when it speaks about the duty of Muslim to make pilgrimage, what does it say? وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنْ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. It is a duty that mankind owes, meaning the believers, Muslims, to make pilgrimage, whoever is able to do it. And then what does it say after that? وَمَنْ كَفَرَ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَنِيٌّ عَنِ الْعَالَمِينَ. Kafara come from the same term. Does that mean that a Muslim who believes that Hajj is required, but he did not do Hajj out of laziness or whatever, or neglect, that he's a kafir in the more serious sense, that he's no longer a Muslim? No, he's beside concealment in a sense of being ungrateful, unthankful to Allah. And that's why in the Quran, actually, in the same ayah, it speaks about the opposites, kufr and shukr. See, وَمَنْ شَكَرَ فَإِنَّمَا يَشْكُرُ نَفْسِهِ وَمَنْ كَفَرَ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَنِيٌّ عَنِ الْعَالَمِينَ. That we find in Surah Luqman, Surah 31. Kufr is the opposite of shukr, being ungrateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then somebody might say, all right, how do we translate kufr then? Should we use the term disbeliever? And is disbeliever always a negative connotation? First of all, just for the sake of information, I'm not making things look lighter or anything of that nature, but just for precision's sake, do you know that every Muslim is a kafir also? By definition, to be a Muslim, it means that you must be a kafir. Shocking, isn't it? Where is the evidence? In the Quran itself. فَمَنْ يَكْفُرْ بِالطَّاغُوتِ, in Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah. فَمَنْ يَكْفُرْ بِالطَّاغُوتِ وَيُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ اسْتَمْسَكَ بِالْعُرْوَةِ الْوُثْقَ لَانْفِصَامَ لَهُ. To believe in the oneness of Allah, that means that you should be kafir of false gods. Yakfur, reject false gods. Is that the only place in the Quran? No. When the Quran speaks about Prophet Ibrahim and those who followed him, what did they say? Inna, to their people, inna bura'a'u minkum wa mimma ta'budun min duni Allahi kafarna bikum. from kufr. They say to those idol worshippers, we dissociate ourselves from you and whatever false gods you worship instead of Allah. Kafarna bikum. We are kafirs of what you're doing. So let's be clear again, what do you mean by disbelief?